So it's our second lesson of advanced server-side scripting with the mean stack. I just want to point out something. I did post an announcement yesterday, but just in case you didn't see it, I think I discussed this back in our towards the end of our ASP.NET class. We've partnered with Microsoft, so we're going to start offering Azure certification exams. We have some vouchers for students. Normally, those exams cost anywhere from $100 to $200, but we have 500 free vouchers available for students if you are interested in attempting one of the fundamental level Microsoft exams. Now, a number of them are not really applicable to us, but probably the one that's most applicable to what we do as web developers is the AZ-900 Azure Fundamentals exam. So you can read more about the exams here. Now, we can't guarantee, because our department is quite large, and you know, there's people in big data, there's people in computer networking, all of them there are relevant Azure exams, but we have 500 vouchers for now. So if you're interested, if you add your name to this spreadsheet, and then we'll see whether we have enough vouchers to provide exam access for everybody who's interested. And we'll probably look at running those exams so you would schedule them and write them online from home. Probably starting over reading week, that 3-week window you will have to be able to schedule an online exam through our partner at Pearson View. So I studied for this and wrote the AZ-900 exam. I think you only have 45 minutes to do the exam, or an hour. I did it back in the summertime, and there's a bunch of training materials available. Some of them are free from Microsoft. There's some really good training materials on LinkedIn Learning. And then I also paid, I think, about $15 for an exam prep course on, I think it was on Udemy, where they had 6 practice tests that you could retake as many times as you wanted to. So if you are interested and you think you'll have some time to study and to do the exam over the next, you know, month and a half, add your name to the spreadsheet. And then we'll divide up the vouchers among the different computer studies programs. And I can provide some study material. Anybody have, and this is totally voluntary, not something you need to do. It's not part of the curriculum, but it is a recognized certification in industry. So it's the kind of thing absolutely you would put on your LinkedIn profile, on your portfolio, and on your resume, that you have an official certification from Microsoft. And this is just the first level, the fundamentals. There are additional, more advanced exams later on, but for this year, this semester, we're starting by offering the fundamentals level exams to interested students. Anybody have any questions about that process? So really right now, we're just asking if you're interested in the program. And if you are, add your name and email to the spreadsheet. And then we will be following up with next steps probably in the next week or two. Okay. So what are we doing today? Let's jump into our lesson 2 folder. So we're going to kind of divide a couple topics today. First, we're going to look at closure structures in JavaScript. We did actually work with closures last week, but we didn't really talk about them. So we want to dissect them and look a little more carefully how that structure works. And then the second part of class, we are going to start using NPM. We talked about it briefly last week, but we'll actually get our hands dirty with it. So I've got a link here. Up on Blackboard explaining closures. This links to a Medium article. So the lesson kind of is based on what's in this article. You do need to log in to read it, I think. So I'm going to go over some of the important features in here. So we'll look at closures and then we'll talk about NPM. So last week, I'm not sure if you've done this before in JavaScript. So here was one of our lines of code last week from our non-blocking. We called a function. We had this callback with this data variable. We referenced it inside, and then we also assigned the entire function to a variable. So this is one example of a closure structure. Is this new? Have you done this before in any of your other JavaScript classes where you assign a variable to a function? Or was last week the first time you would have used this kind of syntax? Just let me know in the chat. It's new, it's not new. Pretty sure it's new. Okay. I kind of expected that it was, but I didn't want to repeat stuff if it isn't new. Okay, so this is kind of a key, and if it is, you didn't spend much time on it. Okay, thanks for that, Colton. So this is one of the techniques involved in a closure. So we'll look at a couple examples and then we're gonna play around with them in our code editor. So the idea of a closure is a function that uses variables from its parent environment. So we'll try this example out shortly. So what do we mean by this? So we've got a function called parent, and then inside we've got a child function. And here we're trying to access the variable that lives within the parent. So we'll try this out in a bit. We'll see this happens. We'll see what happens. This also allows us to do what we did last week. Closures help us allow us to create a function and assign it to a variable, which we can then execute. So what is a closure? It is a function, but it's also its environment. So that includes any variables that live inside of the function. And so what does this matter? What this allows us to do, and we're going to do it all the time in Node, is it allows us to pass functions and their variables to other functions, which sounds kind of, again, meaningless. What does that actually mean? Well, this is a screenshot from the video we watched last week, the intro of Code School, where they talk about the Node event loop. So in Node, our server is constantly checking for different events. And when we call those events, often we need information about those events. So if that event, for example, is an HTTP request, we not only do we need to know that someone's made a request, but we might want to know something like the address parameters, like an ID on the end of the URL. So the closure not only gives us access to the request event, but to any variables or information that that event needs so that we can respond appropriately. So in our Node event loop, we're not simply passing variables along, we actually pass entire functions along for processing the events as we process them in the loop. We'll write a few simple examples, again, based on this article, which will hopefully start to give you the idea. And this little short slide deck is also here on Blackboard for your reference. So let's open up our code editor. For today, I think we can actually just work in the same project that we worked in last week. So I'm just gonna open up my Node Lesson 1 folder where we had our hello world, then we created our server file, and then our blocking and non-blocking. So I think we've got four JavaScript files and our two text files when we were reading out our food and drink. So let's create a new file. We'll play around a little bit. Maybe I'll call this one simple closure.js. So we're going to experiment a little bit with this closure structure. create a function, both variable and a child function. So I'll create a function called parent. Doesn't take any parameters. And let's create a message, a variable here. We'll call that message equals the world. And then we're going to nest another function inside of it. In here, we'll just log out our message. So let's call the parent function. Okay, so we've created a function with a variable and a child function, and then we're going to execute it. So I'll go to my I want to open up my terminal. And let's run our simple closure example. So I'm just going to run node. Actually, before I do, what do you think will happen when we run this file? There's really two options. We might get our message being printed in the console. We might get an error, or we might get no result. Morning, Preston. Any predictions what this code will, what will happen here when we run it? Colton thinks no result, okay. Anybody else? Do you agree with Colton? Do you think our message will show? What do you think? Well, let's try it. So we get nothing. How come? How come our message doesn't get printed out to the console? We don't get any errors. Right, because this function, it lives here, but it never actually gets executed, does it? So if we want it, then we've got to call, after we create the child function, we have to invoke it. So if by adding my call to the child function, I'll run it again. Okay, that wasn't quite the result I expected. Okay, sorry, I hadn't saved my file. So now when we run it, we call parent, which sets the message, we set up the child function, we execute the child function, and now our console prints out hello world. Always helpful to save my changes. So what this tells us, when we call the child function, this function has access to the message from the parent environment. So the closure can contain variables and it can contain child functions that can access these variables that are at the parent scope. Now, what would happen if we did this? So I create the message variable here and assign it a value inside of parent. And then in child, we redeclare it with a different value. Okay, you did do one exercise and it was brief. Okay, so it's good that we're going over it. If I run execute this script again, Jennifer, you think it will be nothing? Okay. Let's see. One key I'm not sure we've talked about before, in your terminal, if you want to repeat your previous command, I could type node simple closure again, but if I just hit the up arrow on my keyboard, it repeats the last command here. So I don't have to retype it every time. I can just hit the up arrow. So now it prints some other message. Why do we get this result now? How come the message changes here? Right, the most local scope always takes priority. Yep, that's right, Jennifer. So we are assigning a new value because a local variable inside of this function is always going to take precedence over the variable from the parent environment, which is broader in scope. All right, I'll just comment that out. We don't actually want that here. Just wanted to show that example. We're going to do another example. We're going to rewrite this example in a little bit of a different way, in the way that's closer to the syntax we're going to see when we're working with Node. So I'll call this simple closure 2.js. Again, we'll make a parent function with a message of hello world. And again, we'll make a child function. But instead of executing the child function here, we're going to return it to the calling code block. So instead of calling, so in our simple closure, right, we actually execute child here. In this case, we are going to return it. We don't put the brackets in. We want to omit brackets. The child doesn't execute yet. We're sending back this child function with a return statement. Now we're going to use a variable and assign that to parent. So let's run this file. We should get the same result we got before. Well, now we're going to run my node simple closure 2. Whoops. In order to execute it, I need the brackets. So I'll repeat my command. And we get the same result. So our child function can access the parent message. We can return this, assign it to a variable, and then execute it after. Okay, so functionally, these are equivalent. Our second version maybe looks a little more complex than our first version, but our second version is actually more functional. And this is the style we're typically going to see when we're working with Node. And we'll look at why in a minute. So that means not only can we call the child function later, but it still has access to that variable, right? This variable gets passed down the chain along with the child. And very commonly in asynchronous programming in JavaScript, we want to be able to pass functions around. And when we pass them, we want those any variables with them, any variables that those functions use to get to go with them. So this closure structure allows that to happen. So we can create a callback function, and then we can pass it as an argument in our event loop. So then we can manipulate any variables that that function needs. So there's two other benefits to using this kind of structure, where we can set up and create the variable in a function, even if we don't execute it right away. The first one has to do with performance and memory. Every time we use a variable, there's a performance cost to doing this. So if we're going to use a function over and over again, we don't want to have to create the same variable every time we call that function. We'd like to be able to create it once and then call our function repeatedly. This also allows us to avoid the use of global variables in JavaScript. Have you guys talked about using global variables at all in either of your other JavaScript classes? Did you ever use them or talk about them? I'm sorry, I'll be right back. I just have to pause for just a second. Sorry about that. Just had a little disturbance here I needed to deal with. Just variable scope. Okay. In general, in JavaScript, we want to avoid using global variables. Number one, if we have a global variable, then that variable persists in memory for the entire lifecycle of the page. Oops, sorry. Unpause. And that's poor for our performance. It can make testing harder as well, and debugging harder because the variable, it's difficult to see how a variable might get changed if it's used in multiple functions. So in general, as JavaScript developers, we want to avoid doing something like this. Like we want to avoid having something like where it's available for our entire page lifecycle. We generally want to try to avoid that. So the closure structure also lets us avoid using global variables. We can create a variable and it's available in that function, but we can pass that function around and still have access to the variable. So the variable can persist when our function is executing multiple times. And we do this all the time in web applications. We have all kinds of processes where we're calling the same function regularly. Can you think of some common examples? Any common example in a web application where we might repeat a process over and over again? Okay, absolutely. That's a good example, Colton. Yeah, we want to play a stream. You know, on YouTube, we want to play, you click a playlist and it should play one after the other. It should play song on Spotify. That's a good example. Yep. So in that case, something like if we were playing a song, right, the playlist or the album, it's going to be the same. We don't want to have to go and fetch into memory the playlist or album each time there's a new song, right? We only want to get it once. So we could have like a fetch album or playlist function that would populate the album or playlist details. And then we would just have like a play song child function. Great example. Can you think of another example of where we might want to run a process repeatedly? What about, think about a shopping cart page. You're going to write the code to populate a shopping cart. What's the what happens repeatedly on that page? Yep, adding to cart. And what about on the cart display page? So you've shopped, you put a bunch of items in your cart, and then you click on the little cart icon. What process is going to run over and over again? Yeah, displaying the items in the cart. Right? So again, we might create a total variable here that we initialize, and then as we, in our child function, we display each cart item. But each cart item needs to reference this parent variable because we need to display and update. We want to update the total as we add each item in our cart. Another really common example would be sending a batch of emails. So let's say we wanted to send, let's say we're a pharmacy, and every morning we have a script running that is reminding people of when their COVID appointments are. So that email at the top, there might be like some introductory text that's standard that goes in all of the emails. But then in a loop, they've got to send each email. And some of those things are going to be particular to each one, like what time each appointment is at, the email address it gets sent to, maybe which vaccine the particular individual booked. So we'll have some kind of boilerplate text we want to be able to create in a message once that we're going to use inside of the child function. So we do these kinds of processes all the time. So we want to be able to set up our parent function and its variables once, and then make repeated calls inside. Let's do another couple of examples here. So I'm going to make a new file. This is going to be, we'll call this open function. So meaning not using a closure. Example without a closure. Well, I'll call my function open function. I'll create a simple counter variable and initialize it to zero. Then every time the function gets called, we'll add one. Okay, so start at zero, add one, print out the value of the counter. So I'll just call open function twice. if we execute this file, what result do you think we're going to get in our console? Colton says one and then two. Okay, anybody else? What's your expectation? Is it going to say one and two? Do you think it's going to show something else? Remember, there is no closure here. So let's run the file. Again, it helps if I save my work. And we got a one the first time. How come we got one again? So this was maybe not the result. So we haven't used a closure here and it gave us the same value each time. Anybody, any guesses as to why it gave us one each time we called that function? Yeah, exactly, Jennifer. We're asking for the same thing. So on line 9, we are creating and executing the function, and each time it's initializing the variable to 0. It adds 1 and prints it out. So it doesn't matter how many times we do this, we are starting at 0 every time without a closure, because in this case, we haven't used a closure. So I can call this function a million times. It's only ever going to print one. So this variable is being created in memory and initialized to 0 every time we try to call it. So from a memory management perspective, this isn't very good because we are constantly creating this same variable and initializing it to 0. Let's write this example, rewrite it, but this time we're going to use a closure and we can compare how it works. So now we'll make a closed function, a JS. So we'll use counter variable with a closure this time. I'll call it closed function. And again, we're going to create the exact same variable. We'll initialize it with the exact same value. This time, increment within a child function assigned to a variable. Sorry, whoops, we'll leave that out. We'll rewrite that later. So now I've got an anonymous function this time, and I'm going to assign it to a variable. And again, we'll do the same thing inside. We'll increment and we'll log. And then we will return our variable. So now we've used a closure this time. So now we will assign a variable to the function. Don't execute it immediately. So I'll create a new variable and assign it to the function. But it doesn't actually run yet. And now we want to run this several times. So in this case, similar logic to the function, but different structure. Our last file, it was an open function. This time we've used a closure. So what result, what are we going to get when we run it this time? Thinking 1, 2, and 3? Okay, let's see. So I'll run node, closed function, and yep. Colton, that's right. I get 1, 2, I know a little bit hard to see in my terminal, 1, 2, and 3. So when line 15 executes, we're creating the counter variable and setting it to 0. That means this variable, each time we call countMe and execute our child function, this variable persists. It doesn't get destroyed and recreated every time. So if this was something like a shopping cart total, we could increment it. We could keep a running total as we run our child function. We still have access to manipulate this variable repeatedly rather than creating it over and over again like we did here. And notice our function here is anonymous. There's no name given to it. We don't really need to call it anything. We can, but it's not necessary. And typically these function names will be anonymous. And then we'll look at some other syntax, some shorthand syntax for anonymous functions as well. Okay, so this open function structure, we're not going to see this very much in Node. We're going to see this closed function with the anonymous. And these anonymous functions, these are typically going to be our callback functions. We actually saw it last week in our non-blocking. So this is just another way of writing our anonymous function. Instead of the word function, we just use the lambda or the arrow afterwards. So I'll So I could replace the word function here with a lambda or a fat arrow expression over here. And this is the syntax we're actually going to be using through this course. We did it last week. We didn't really talk about it. I will push these few files up to Git. So we've got some examples. So these are our closure examples. I realize this structure, the syntax is new, the structure and the whole concept, it's fairly new. So it takes a little while to get used to these things, to get used to the syntax and to the whole idea of a closure. the nested functions where we can pass functions and variables around to other functions. So if you feel kind of like, hey, I'm confused, that's okay. That's normal. As we work with this syntax more and more, it will become more familiar and more comfortable, less strange. Does anybody have questions about any of the files that we've worked on so far today? Anything you really would like to look at again and go over again? Okay, I'm not seeing any questions. So these examples, they're all on GitHub now in the same repository from last week. And again, this closure syntax, we're going to work with it regularly, so it'll get easier. So I want to talk a little bit about NPM just before we take a break, and then we'll come back and we will play around with NPM. We did introduce it briefly last week. So NPM is the Node Package Manager, which is an online registry of third-party open source packages that we can download and we can install into our application. And typically we access it through the CLI, through our command line, so that we can manage. And Microsoft's NuGet Package Manager, it was based on the Node Package Manager. It's also another kind of competitor to NPM called Yarn. So it's really easy to use NPM. When we find a package we like, we just run the command npm I, or you can type the word install, but it's now shortened to I, and then the package name. The package names never have spaces, so they're not case sensitive, but if they have multiple words, they're typically separated by hyphens. So for example, we can go and look at the main npm site. So if let's say we wanted something like Google Map, right? So there's, you can see all the packages and the words are separated with dashes. So here, adding custom markers to Google Map. And it says, you know, we would run the command npm install or npm I and then Google Map marker. And it shows you the repository of where the source code lives that would get copied down to our development machine. And when we do, the packages by default get saved to a folder that'll get created in our project called node_modules. And the packages can also be versioned. We saw versioning with NuGet packages. So the NPM packages also have this kind of version. We can uninstall a package if we don't need it anymore. We can update a package if there's a new version with NPM update. And in our project, we're going to see a file called package.json. So what package.json does is a JSON file that keeps track of all of the dependencies of our application. So it might look something like this. So it gives us a dependency section, and this project depends on uses the express package and let's say the grunt package. And this file gets updated automatically anytime we install a new dependency. There's also a little command line utility which we'll use called npm init. It's kind of like a wizard. It'll ask us a few questions and it will build the package.json file for us. So we'll use this today. And then when we want to use one of the modules that we've installed, we just use the require method to include that package in a particular JavaScript file where we want to use it. And Node has some modules that come with it. So for example, we already used this last week where we required the file system or the HTTP library that comes with Node. And we also have the ability to make your own packages and publish them to NPM. If you create a module and you want to share it with other developers, then you can actually publish here to NPM. Okay, so we're gonna do a bit of a deeper dive and we're gonna play around with NPM in the remaining time we've got today. Okay, it is almost 10 to 10. Let's take a 10-minute break here. So the code we've done is already on GitHub. We will come back at 10 o'clock. We'll take a pause and then we'll dive into NPM.